Almighty God, we just ask you today, Father God, move in the hearts and lives of these people that's lost and undone without a Savior, Lord. We love you, we praise you, we exalt you, Lord. Help us to be a light in the dark world. For Jesus, God, we pray the Father, Lord, for his great protection. Lord, we pray for revival that's coming, Lord. We pray for the sick, the afflicted today, God. Oh, Jesus, God, that in their home, Lord Jesus, would you give them comfort today, Lord? Strengthen them with their greetings today. Father, help us, Lord, just to go forward as men and women that love the Lord. God, please bring old time conviction power upon these people today. God, help them to see a need in their life for you today. God, help send them dreams and visions on their bed at night. God, make it real to them, God. Help them to see they needed a lot, needed you in their life today. More than anything, we pray in Jesus' most holy and precious name. Amen.
He was supposed to have been able to come, but evidently she didn't want to open the door. He comes up singing something.
Four thirty-four. I know who holds tomorrow, and I know who holds my hand. Amen. This is the day the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad. Right? Amen. And amen.
To Consider all Anybody else have one? How about we do all fly away and have fellowship as we fly away?
6:48.
Let's have fellowship on this one.
Tonight that you remember Brother number one pal's son Kenny. He is not well at all. Matter of fact, it's just a matter of time. But I understand that you'll be going home. Also pray for Sister Mickey Smith of the Addison Free Will Baptist Church. Yesterday her son told me that she just had a couple of days, is what the nurse was saying. And that's Rick's aunt, Rick Marcus's aunt, and more like a sister or a mother to him. They're very, very close. And a big part of that church down there. So I'd ask you to remember that whole church. Someone else?
Also remember Carrie and Norman.
Yeah.
Remember the lost in our family and our youth group and our families.
Today, Jamie, my boss's father, they took him to the hospital, thought maybe he had a heart attack, so pray for that family.
Just remember Dale McManus, needs prayer. He's trying to get in somewhere up the pumps, I think, for the party.
Someone else?
Continue to remember Sarah's dad. He's having some problems there.
Who's the young lady you've been requesting prayer for? She's got cancer. Can you remember her?
Debbie Cohen.
Debbie.
I guess I got her name wrong.
Okay.
Well, Larry told me so.
Someone else.
Continue to remember all the ones in the nursing home and hospitals. Should be
prayers.
Do you be much in prayer for the revival that's actually last week of this month. Starts January the 23rd, Brother Jackie Grimm will be here Monday through Friday. And of course our men's retreat is a weekend before it, so the men ought to be geared up and ready to go for that.
Reverend Jerry and Jeremy, remember when the aunt and uncle Jeanette were born?
Someone else.
Remember the loss in my family, which is all right.
Let's pray for Brother Charlie. We'll say pray for Brother Larry back there. He's got some more tests coming up. When you go back.
Weather don't look too good tomorrow, so remember me and you just go to the office.
They're just waiting on an insurance approval for an MRI.
Lost in my family.
Pray for my sister and Joe's wife as she travels home from Columbus in the morning. Yeah. Not long she can be wore out. Snow, she might get some of that snow coming home.
I told her if it's slick, stay there. I'd rather see her stay and let the weather clear up or whatever and get traveled. Think of Gary and Cheryl want me in here, you know. Pray for them.
Anyone else?
If you travel tomorrow evening, well, far afternoon up and then tomorrow night coming back, so.
Lost in John David's family. Also, Randy is in rehab. Am I right on that? Do you know? You heard from Gina? He's supposed to be in rehab, so you can get a hold of him. Randy Polo.
Gina did tell me that she was going to church out there by her house Sunday. Now, whether she did or not, I don't know, because I haven't talked to her since then. But
remember our principal.
He has colon cancer. Most of all, he says he's atheist. Doesn't believe in God.
How's Aaron doing?
Aaron. Fortner, we haven't heard anything bad on him in a while. On the post pictures I've seen him posted for Christmas there, he seemed like he was doing okay. So that's good news. Pray for Darren. I don't know if they figured out what's wrong with his heart yet, but he's still he's got tested. I haven't heard anything on that either. Sickness all around us. All around us. We don't know who's going to strike next. Unspoken request uplifted the hands. Amen. Will Larry Morton lead us in all prayer?
Dear Lord, Almighty God, we love you. We praise you.
Father, we thank you.
Help us, Lord.
Thank you for all that you have done.
Father, we come to you now. Failures and mistakes. Take care of the
Father.
Jesus, my Christ,
Lord, we just pray right now.
Lord, we have nothing to do.
Jesus,
Lord,
what you have to do. Thank you. Turning always physically. Father, we do pray. And you can be asked to the center of the ground or others. Not give us
what you live in as
much as our minds are. We know that it is under the body of Jesus. We just pray in this time, Lord, that we make it happen.
Jesus,
the word,
Christian,
praise
to you,
the
Muslims, the
Lord,
while Jesus and the other churches reach down to bring peace to their hearts and lives, Lord. We praise and exalt you, Father, for us and use us for thy glory, Lord. Comfort all those that are fighting cancer, these that are grieving, Lord. Pray saints that are almost home, and you are peaceful crossing, Lord. The souls that are lost and undone, Father, Lord, that you give them to take that step of death, Lord. I pray, God, open your eyes, Lord Jesus, and let them see the wounds, God, the thoughts to them. They'll turn to you, Lord, Lord. I know it's not your will they perish. Then give them one more chance. Lord Jesus, have your way, God, we pray. We hold in your precious name.
Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Imagine that.
Had that right on the end of my tongue.
Till I heard a sweet voice say, thank you, you're sure.
going to get up and testify. Brag on the Lord.
I'd be glad to. I love him. And he's always good to me. And I just want to give him praise and honor and glory. You know, I just pray my prayers. They help me get closer and closer and closer to him every day. And I just love him.
So, John.
Jamie, I just received a text that I think it's called Bundy Heights. The apartments down by the high school is on fire, and it's so bad they called in Hampton and possibly calling others here.
Oh, so.
I know there's a lot of people with kids there.
Let's circle up and have a prayer just for that need right there. That's going to put a lot of people out of their homes. Safety, number one.
You pray
safety.
For the firefighters too, because when it's cold like that, that water freezes.
Yep.
I know.
You get red, you're just like.
No head grade.
Well, Charlie, the Bundy apartment's down there on fire, right? So we're going to pray for the firefighters and those people that everybody will be safe. And
I know we're safe.
You know, some people are going to be without their homes tonight.
Kathy, thank you. Say
that's where your sister is. I'm
not caring for a little bit. Sorry. Almighty God, we call
on your God. God in heaven, as we come to you, again, Lord.
The very day
half of what's going on down there.
I ask, Lord, protection of the firefighters, which you just called away, Lord.
Father, we
protect them, Lord, the residents, which is this part of you. I know that you're able to do far exceedingly, but Lord, we can take your eyes. Lord, some are going to lose their home, but Jesus, go for the Lord, keep them safe, Lord God. I pray today, Lord, things be in place, Lord, those lives which Jesus are present today. I pray for the firefighters, which Jesus protect them, God, in a mighty way. Put your hedge about it, Lord Jesus. Let them knock it down quickly, Lord. We pray in your holy and precious name today.
Amen.
Amen. Mary will be fine then, will you?
No time.
Maybe probably will, though.
Probably will.
Yeah.
I'll stand up and say I love the Lord and thank him for all he does for us and giving gift to us more than we could ever repay him or thank him or praise him enough for. I just love him for.
She's going to sing good.
Amen.
Get it.
Never long, for the God on the mountain. me when things go wrong. He'll make them right, and the God of the good times, He's still finding the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. He found the faith when you're up on the mountain. Oh, but the talk comes so easy when life's at its best. But it's down in the valley of trials and temptation, that's when faith is really put to the test. Oh, the God on the mountain, He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times, He's still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. The God of the day is still God in the night.
I'm thankful to be able to trust in my Lord day or night. I praise Him, man.
And say, I love the Lord. Thank you for saving my soul.
Amen.
Thank you for that made the impressions on my new teeth today, so hopefully that ain't very far down the road. I can get back to eating again. Yep, thank you for that.
Praise God. They had to cut his hair too, so. Somebody else. Got everybody?
Come on.
Stand the sound of the Lord, I thank you for everything He's done for us, my family. He's been with us through a lot of hard times, but there's been a lot of good times, and I just thank you for everything.
Yeah, I got to thinking, after you said all your family's lost, all of them, ain't this little girl in Cincinnati, she's Christian.
Yeah, that's right. Amen.
Someone else.
Sorry.
All right. Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1.
We will close out our service different today. And if you're going to the men's retreat, you got to fill out one of these forms today. All right, before we leave here tonight. I got more than enough. You can go later, it just costs more. I've been in contact with a guy from Kenya through Facebook, and he asked for some sermons. So we are sending 10 CDs to Kenya for a start and see where God leads it from there. And we're going to gather around before we leave here today. And I know that God anointed these messages when He gave them. And I want to ask God to anoint them as they go out. That blows my mind that we can do that, that we can send that around on the other side of the world. And the guy has already in a roundabout way asked me about coming over there, but that's a long way from home. But you know what? If God opened the door to go for a couple of weeks, I would go. If God opened that door and He said go, and God dropped it in the money in her lap to do it, because man, just the airfare to get there, have someone pick you up at an airport to take you to those little villages, would be, just for one person, would probably be $5,000 or $6,000. Just, you know, I'm just guessing at that. I haven't run or went anything for it with that, but I just wanted to share that with you that, you know, God, again, my friend told me 2 weeks ago that Facebook wasn't a message or a tool for God. And yet, because of that Facebook, these are going to Kenya. So, you know, and I told him, I said, we share all of our messages on there. Derek shares them on our church page, which I haven't added this guy to yet, but I will. And then quick as he shares them, I take them and share them on my regular page. And everybody that's on Facebook should do the same. Because you have friends that I don't have. And if they watch it, I realize I went and checked it today. Sunday morning's sermon has had 287 views. And I realize that some of those were us. But if every one of us that has a Facebook account, probably wouldn't be any more than 20 people out of our church that has a Facebook account that possibly watched that. So out of 200, that means at least 267 people that were not in this building have watched that sermon, or at least parts of it. And if they watch parts of it, God will get a hold of them, right? Amen. I just believe that with all of my heart today. And He sure is a good God, isn't He? All right. Titus chapter 1, the epistle of Paul to Titus. Again, this is another, as we have been studying for quite a while now, one of the letters that Paul wrote. Last week we studied in 2 Timothy chapter 4, Paul's farewell speech before he went to Nero's block. But this is another young man that was converted under Paul's ministry, that Paul left to be a pastor in one of the churches. The main subject matter of it is apostolic, complete, and I can't read that little bitty writing down there today. So anyhow, first verse says, Paul, an apostle of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the knowledge, acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness. Now, what is truth? Thy word is truth, O Lord. For us to be saved, we have to acknowledge the word of God. True? I mean, it is what, if we take this book and if we could get rid of it and say that God never gave it to us, there'd be no sin. Where there is no law, sin is not imputed. Now, maybe that's why some of them want to take the Old Testament out of it and just follow the New. But you can't, because it the Old is actually, a lot of it is quoted and written down here in the New. I realize today that the genealogy parts are there for somebody besides higher than me, other than to say somebody begat. And what it does is just prove where we came from. Our family tree. Right? So, faith, according to the faith of God's elect, and that being Israel, and the acknowledging of the truth which is after godliness. You cannot study this book and continue in sin. It'll either drive you from the book, or it'll drive you from the sin. Verse 2. In hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised, listen to this phrase, before yesterday. Before 2,000 years ago? No. Before Christ died? Before the world began. Eternal life through what? What was the God promise? That he who believes in... We covered this in the youth group the other night. Now, where did Derek go? What was God's promise, Derek, there? That's right. For God did not send his Son in the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. We have eternal life. That promise is given, again, before he hung the first star. What a God we serve. I mean, how many's ever had a car accident? If you've been driving any time at all, you've had them. You that ain't drove much yet, hang on. Hannah about had her first one Sunday night. Oh, gosh, scared me to death. Me hollering, stop, stop, stop. If you knew that you was going to wreck, would you have done something different? Come on, think about it now. We all would. We'd have did whatever it took to avoid it. Now, right? All right. So, if I was God, and I knew that I was going to create this man perfect, and give this man a choice, and know that this man would choose wrong over right, because that's what happened. They chose to disobey God, to believe a lie. That's what they did. They believed the lie and said, well, you know, maybe we won't die. Because that's what the devil said. You know, you're not really going to die. I mean, in so many words, all right? It's not written out exactly that way, but, you know, hath not God said, ye shall not. Ye shall not surely die. So if I knew, if I was God, and I knew that that man was going to disobey me, and that I'd have to give my only begotten son for that piece of dirt, do you think I'd have created man? Would you, Dave, J. John? Larry? John? Harold? What about it? Would you? Would you, Charlie? But we're not God. That's what we've got to put in there. For God so loved, before the world began, he made that promise that whosoever would believe on him whom he sent, that being his own son. God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world, that the world through him might be saved.
Man's salvation was way back in the world.
Which God, the hope of eternal life, which God that cannot lie. Cannot lie. You know what that means? Not only this promise of eternal life, but I can name off some other promises real fast. I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. I will go with thee all the way even to thee. God didn't lie on that. He has never left anybody in here alone. He is there. There's a song that says he was there all the time, waiting patiently in life. He was there all the time. Here's another promise that he made to us. I will not allow you to be tempted above that which you're able to bear, but with the temptation I will make a way of escape. That's a promise that God cannot lie. Here's one for you. The nation of Israel, again, the UN, last week, you know, they're trying to tell Israel, you've got to give that land back. God gave it to them over 3,000 years ago, and God cannot lie. It's theirs. Now, our president that we have now, not the president-elect, says they need to give it back. The rest of the world says they need it back. Do you know that Monday there in Indonesia, there was a Christian president elected the first time ever in the nation of Indonesia. So you know what the Muslims decided to do? They're destroying that country. They're rioting everywhere you look. All because of a Christian president. Why didn't they get out and vote against him then? I mean, because Indonesia is a Muslim nation. All right. Verse 3. But hath in due times manifest his word through preaching. That word manifested there means God made known. God, it would read like this. Now, please don't go home and say, Pastor's changing the word of God again. But hath in due times made known his word through preaching. The preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto them that are saved, it is the power of God unto salvation. That's Romans chapter 1. Or 1 Corinthians chapter 1. One of the two. Maybe it's 1 Corinthians chapter 1. The power of God unto them. All right. They made known his word through preaching, which is committed unto me according to the commandment of God our Savior. You know, whatever your calling is in the church today, you're not to take it lightly. If it's to preach, if it's to teach, if it's to be a deacon, if it's to be a teacher, if it's to be a prayer warrior, every job in the church today, folks, is an important job. Every job. There's no greater jobs. Just because I'm pastor, that don't mean my job. It means I have responsibilities. As a pastor, as a prayer warrior, you've got responsibilities, right? As a teacher, there's responsibilities. As a deacon, the responsibilities are just different. That don't mean one's more important than the other. To Titus, mine own son, after the common faith, grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ our Savior. Now here's Paul's salutation. Paul, again, he starts out, you know, why, who sent him? Now he starts, turns it directly to Titus. Again, mine own son, after, I told you, he's the one that preached the message that this young man was saved under. For this cause left thee I at Crete, that thou shouldest set in order the things that were wanting, and ordain elders in every city, as I have appointed thee. Paul charged this young man. That's what he means when that word appointed there. When you're appointed to do something, you have been given a charge, which means authority to get something accomplished. To do the act that you're charged to do. A command, if you'll have it. He said, I left thee at Crete that thou shouldest set in order. In other words, make sure things are done proper. If any man be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, for a bishop must be blameless as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to much wine, nor striker, nor given over to filthy lucre, but a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word which he hath been taught, that he may be able to, by sound doctrine, both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. Paul goes into, again, and we've studied this before, on the qualifications of a preacher or a pastor, or he calls it a bishop. Now, again, I don't think that we need to go through them. One by one, we will if someone feels that we need to. Simply because we have blameless husband and one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot. In other words, you've got to be of a good reputation. You know, the Bible said, beware of the man that's well spoken of by everyone. Common sense tells you, beware of the man that nobody's got anything good to say about. Is that not right? And I think this applies here. If you've got a bad reputation, don't expect to be put in a position of authority. If you can't rule your own house, if you can't control your tongue, if you can't, it would not even
But a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, if you're hanging, all you do is hang around the wrong crowd and you've got a bad reputation out in public, you've got no business holding an office in a church, especially this office, right? If I cannot live it, I cannot, there's no use for me to preach it. And that's what he's saying here. For he must be able by sound doctrine to exhort, in other words, to explain, to strongly urge, to convince the gainsayers. Who's the gainsayers? It's sinners or unbelievers is just simply the best way to put it, huh? A gainsayer is someone really that speaks against what you're speaking of. If you and I are talking one-on-one and you are not a Christian and you've got all these, I should be able with authority and with power to exhort and to convince you that I'm right concerning the Word of God and that you're in the wrong. Right? That's what Paul's saying here. To convince the gainslayers, in other words, them that again, are out stirring up strife. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision. We've got to remember, everywhere Paul went, there was a group of men that followed Paul from city to city to city to do nothing but to say, this man is a phony, this man is a liar. I mean, he used to kill the very people that he's trying to convince you to be. He may turn on you at any second. I mean, they would outright lie on Paul.
These were the Jews.
Them of the circumcision, the Jews that followed Paul from Jerusalem, everywhere Paul went. If you're going to take a stand for Jesus Christ, guess what? You're going to suffer persecution. Jesus said, you know, think it not strange when they talk about you, when they say all manner of evil against you, for they said it of me first. They hated him without a cause. You know why the cause that they hate you is Jesus. He was hated without cause, but you're hated because of him. The devil don't like you. And I'm going to tell you, he will enter into the heart. I mean, there are people, listen, I realize God's grace it can reach farther than what we ever have. But there have people right now living in this world that have went too far. Yeah. That God will never speak to again. Turned them over to the hardness of their heart, to a reprobate mind. They believe a lie and are damned. And they're anti-God. Anything that's against God, they'll do everything they can to convince you of something else. I'm going to tell you, them people's in trouble. You know why? They are already condemned to hell. There's no hope for them in this world or in the world to come, according to the Word of God. Whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert the whole houses, teaching things which they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. I had a fellow ask me today, that I'm not sure whether he's Christian or not. I know at one time he confessed and he actually attended the Rutland Church of God, and he and I were talking, and he said, why is it that you don't see preachers preach on television anymore? Even in churches, he said, people get up and they talk, he said, but they ain't none of them preachers like what I know you preach. And I said, well, everybody don't have to maybe yell and scream and get excited like I do or whatever you want to call it. I said, what makes it preaching is the anointing of God. And I'm going to tell you something. If the Spirit of God is not there bearing witness, but they're not of God. I mean, if all they're doing is patting people on the back, I'm going to tell you, what the world wants is everybody tell them that they're good. Nobody wants to be told they're no good. At anything, am I right? If Why, that Dave J. John, he's the sorriest truck driver that ever got behind the wheel. Dave wouldn't want to hear something like that. I mean, all the years that he drove and all the years that Larry and Johnny and all these fellas, you know, that they drove. I mean, go ask them how many wrecks they had. They evidently did pretty good hauling them loads up and down the road. You know, John's evidently a pretty good electrician and carpenter and everything, lays tile. You know how I know? He's still got a good job. If you're in the day we live in, if you don't do your job well, they're going to get rid of you. They're going to find somebody that will. It's the same thing in the church. We have people, again, that are patting people on the back and saying, you know, it's all right. God loves you. We're just all God's children. We're just one big happy family. We're all, you know, we're all of this. As long as a person has got faith, I hear that all the time. As long as you've got faith, you're all right. Just got to believe. Believe in what? The devil believes and trembles. He believes every word in this book and he trembles at it. You know why? He saw the back of the book too, I believe, and knows his destination, what lies out there. If men knew in their heart of hearts that hell was waiting on them when they die, and that was my exact thing to him. I said, now, Ray, I want you to understand something. I said, about religion, I said, there's only one way to get to heaven, and that's by the blood of Jesus Christ. And if you don't have the blood applied, then you're going to hell. And he said, that's exactly right. Which surprised me. I pray the fellow's right. I pray he's right. Next time I'm there, maybe I just ought to ask him. What do you think? Sound like a plan, don't it? One of themselves, even a prophet of their own, said, the Christians are always liars, evil beasts, slow bellies. How you going to win anybody talking to them like that, right? I mean, here they're trying to win them. Now they also tell them that they're liars, always liars, they're evil beasts, they're slow bellies. This witness is true. Therefore, rebuke them sharply that they may be sound in the faith. He said, just get nose to nose to them and just tell them exactly how it is. Isn't that what he's saying? Rebuke them sharply. Get their attention. Accuse them openly, right? Not giving heed to Jewish fables and commandments of men, but that turn from the truth. You see, that's what was wrong that's what's wrong even some today, is that they follow more the traditions of men. That was what's wrong in Jesus' day. The traditions of the elders were more important than the Word of God. And that's what these Jews were coming behind Paul and teaching. You know, the only way you can get to be part of this family, if you're circumcised, you're all right. You send your money on down to the church house. You see, because they didn't have the daily sacrifice no more. Under the law, the Jewish men were required to appear before God at least 3 times a year. There was 3 that was required that they come there to Jerusalem to offer up a sacrifice. Then, see, that was taken away from them. Where it all started at is after Solomon's death. They come to Solomon's son and said, listen, your dad was hard on us. I mean, he put a great burden on us. If you'll lighten our load a little bit, we'll serve you all the days of our life. You'll be our king. We'll walk hand in hand. He said, give me 3 days to think on this. And he talked to the old men, and the old men said, you know, they will. They'll love you. If you do what they ask, they'll love you. The young boy said, wait a minute. You're the king. You don't have to give them nothing. And 10 tribes of the kingdom left. All right? They elected Jeroboam king over those 10 tribes. Jeroboam said, wait a minute. Fellas, let's think about this. The temple of God's in Jerusalem. If these people go back to Jerusalem to worship,
I'll lose them. I tell you what we'll do. Let's build two golden calves and say, these be thy gods, O Israel, that brought thee up out of Egypt. You see, men want something they can see. Has anybody ever seen God face to face? No, but I sure seen where he been. I've never reached out and actually touched God, Brother Charlie, but I sure felt his hand touch me. Amen?
Amen.
We walk by faith and not by sight. That's where got all that, all the trouble. That's what got them in where they're at today. The hardness of their heart, their rebellion. Men are, we're no better. If it weren't for grace today, we'd be hurting.
Amen.
We're no better. We can't point the finger at them. We're no better. Because if it wasn't for grace that was bestowed upon us and God's love toward us, you remember, we were counted as outcasts and dogs anyhow.
Yes, we were. And this is just for a season.
And it's just for a season. This grace dispensation, I believe, I personally believe the grace dispensation will soon come to an end. Unto the pure, verse 15. Unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure, but even their mind with and conscience is defiled. In other words, you have been purified by the blood of Jesus Christ. Again, what can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again or pure again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Our garments are spotted and stained without that. They profess that they know God, but in their works they deny Him, being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work reprobate. Unto every good work reprobate. The word reprobate means unusable, unfit. Everything that they try to do is unfit. Let me tell you why. Because it's by grace through faith. If I'm trying to, and that's what these Jews were saying, the only way you can get there is, number one, you've got to be circumcised to be part of the family. After you're circumcised, you've got to live the letter of the law. In other words, all these traditions we got here. Right? I mean, think about it. The Pharisee would stand on the street corner. He would, when he got ready to fast, you know, he would paint his face up and adorn himself, you know, and put on a big, long, sad face and let everybody know, I've been fasting for the last 3 days. You know, there's a thing going around now called a Daniel fast. Anybody ever hear of it? It's where you only eat certain things. It's a 21-day thing, but I've got to thinking about that. Is that fasting? Everywhere I find fasting in the Word of God, people don't eat or drink. Not that they cut back. I'm not trying, you know, that's just how I understand the Word of God. And I've looked at that a couple of times and had people send me different copies of it and whatever and just laid it down. I think if we're going to fast, let's, not do it as unto men. I mean, I know churches, they'll say, okay, everybody, we're going to start a Daniel fast on such and such a day, and we're going to do it as the whole church. I think fasting is like our giving. Don't let our right hand know what our left hand's doing. Jesus said, don't appear unto men. He said, anoint thy head with oil, walk around with a smile. You know, don't be sorrowful. Get up. Go about your daily life. It's good. When you get along with God, then you can agonize with God. But don't appear unto men, but get your glory now. And that's what these folks love to do. They love to be seen of men, love to be heard. Would make long, you know, the best testimony that you can give is, thank God for saving a wretch like me. That's a great testimony.
All, I mean, everything else that we add on is just, you know, if we get me getting up and telling how bad the devil's beat me up this week is not glorifying God. That's not a testimony for God. I can tell you that, say, hey, you know, it's been rough this week, but God has been good. God has been faithful. God has delivered. Now, that's glorifying God. Amen? All right. That's Titus chapter 1. We'll close right there. I want everybody will that gather around. I'm going to leave them right there. And I want everybody to gather around. And